For coming to do some work this morning, but we get a half day off today. Raymond, so you have to move between the meetings. Thank you. Now, Andrew and your team, I won't introduce you one by one. Welcome again, and thank you for coming back. And Jeffrey, of course, good morning. First of all, declaration or disclosure of interest. Do you have anything else to declare? Last time you already made a declaration or disclosure. Do you need to add to that disclosure? Well, just to be safe, you know, I need to declare everything. I can't recall whether I attended any of these mega events. I might have been invited to some of these mega events, but there's no direct interest involved. Yes, it's better to play safe. Mr. Lam, can you please go through their rights? Yes, for those invited, the witnesses invited to the hearing, with the exception of government officials, all other witnesses are not protected under the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, Cap 382. And nor do they enjoy any exemptions under this ordinance. Thank you. Well, you received a whole bundle of documents last night. I'm sure perhaps you didn't have a chance to read them, but actually it's fine. We could leave the questions till another hearing. Four documents, right? Four such documents. Today, we will first of all deal with the ICAC document. We only got it last night, actually. Gen 14, have you got it? Before we go to that, Andrew, do you have anything to say on Gen 14, please? It's the ICAC document. Today, we are going to go through this paper first. So we'll first go to ICAC before we come back to you, Paul, okay? Mr. Wong? In response to the committee's request, we provided a report from the Corruption Prevention Department of the ICAC on the Mega Events Fund. There's also a cover letter for the report, which we have also furnished. And then members have also asked us to furnish our reply to the Corruption Prevention Department, you know, on the update on implementation of the recommendations in the assignment report. Now, in our reply letter, we explained our position, because members asked how come on that day we did not make specific mention of this issue at the Finance Committee meeting. We submitted a paper that we submitted to the Finance Committee, and we've given a reply to that. Thank you. Paul, who would like to start off first with questions? Can I have a show of hands? Yeah. Okay, let's jot down the name. Perhaps we should let Raymond ask questions first, because he has to go to another meeting. Well, you know, Paul, maybe you could just ask a quick point, and I don't mind to let Raymond go first. Okay, then. 15 minutes per member, okay? Well, it's fine, you know, the other meeting, someone is chairing it, because there's a special meeting. I'm the chairman, but now the deputy chairman is chairing the meeting. the deputy chairman, you know, is standing in for me, so it won't happen. You know, what happened with Mr. Ng yesterday would happen here. Anyway, so you can get started, Paul. You could start first. 10 minutes, perhaps. If I may first refer you to para 1.10 and 1.11 of the audit report. And then, if I may also refer you to the latest paper just mentioned by the chairman, Gen 14, or Gen 4 rather, page 5 of the letter of the Tourism Commission. And I would also like to refer you to the ICAC paper. I will deal with all these together. Just to refresh your memory, last time I and Mr. Alan Leung asked, I think it was in 2010 or around that time, the ICAC conducted a review. I think it wrote to the Tourism Commission or the Secretariat of the MEF. It's about the past practices of the fund, and the ICAC also made some recommendations. Now, I think the controversial point is actually para 1.11 of the audit report. It's mentioned there. The ICAC raises concern with the need for continuing the MEF, which was set up at a time of financial difficulties, and in view of the changed economic situation, suggested that the TC should consider returning the unused funds to the government. I'm sure members recall last time we touched on this point during the hearing. Paul, could you please quote Gen 14, NXT 1, the letter of the ICAC, please? This is the one we went through this morning. So what is the basis? Now, Gen 4, actually, I refer to Gen 4, pages 4 and 5. It's in English only. The Tourism Commission said that for the ICAC's assignment report, there are no recommendations as such as to whether the MBF fund should be continued. So that's in the reply letter. The permanent secretary or the tourism commissioner, at that time, what was your understanding of the recommendation of the ICAC? Mr. Yong? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me give you a bit more background, if with your permission. The Mega Events Fund started operation in 2009. Please, your microphone. Can you just wait a second? Move the microphone closer to you, please, because we need to record what you said. Is it better now? No. I just said that in 2009, the Mega Events Fund was set up. Since that time, the ICAC was involved in helping the fund come up with corruption prevention measures. And then by 2010, as mentioned in the paper, in 2010, the Corruption Prevention Department of the ICAC conducted further studies. As you know, the Corruption Prevention Department does offer corruption prevention advice to government departments as part of their routine tasks. And so mechanisms in place to prevent corruption. But then in the assignment report, there's recommendation that certain areas need to be strengthened. So as we had a detailed internal discussion on how we would implement the recommendations in the report. And in the documents we submitted today, there's a letter dated the 1st of February 2011 to the Corruption Prevention Department. We gave a report on how we would implement the further corruption prevention measures. Now, on the Mega Events Fund, when it was set up, we were in financial difficulties, so the circumstances changed. Was there a need to continue with the fund? There was a colleague in the Corruption Prevention Department who wrote to me on the 15th of November 2011. And he conveyed the views of, I believe, some members of the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee. But one point is for sure. In the recommendations given to us by the Corruption Prevention Department, there is no recommendation on whether the MEF should continue with the changing financial economic circumstances. But rather, the recommendations given to us were forward-looking. That is how we could do better in preventing corruption in relation to the operation of the fund. So after internal discussion, we decided how we would implement the recommendations and we informed the Corruption Prevention Department. Now in the CPD's letter to us, views of individual members of the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee were conveyed. That is, the economic situation has improved, so was there a need to keep the MEF? In 2011, when we conducted a review on the MEF, we did take into account that factor. That is, the economic situation has improved, if there's a need to keep the MEF. Now, actually, at the time, yes, the economy changed, but there were other factors still at play, and we thought it was necessary to keep the MEF. For example, our competitors in the region, they were plowing in resources to stage major events. And then from 2009 to 2011, during the operation of the MEF, we saw a lot of support from the sector, and we saw that the fund helped the development of the tourism sector. So that's why in 2012, when we went to the Finance Committee to apply for an amendment to the MEF, adding an additional layer so we could expand the scope of the fund, and then we could consider more varieties of mega events. So it's a reform of the MEF. So that's how the whole fund evolved. And in the operation of the MEF, we have taken on board fully the recommendations of the ICAC. And as we consider the future of the MPF, we did take into account various factors, including the changes in the economic circumstances. Thank you. Paul, you have just recapped the evidence given at the last hearing in one go. Now, the chairman reminded me of the ICAC letter, Gen 14. It's dated the 15th of November 2010. Let me read out part of the letter because it's crucial. Second paragraph.
Mandated TC should issue more stringent guidelines for staff in evaluating events that involve substantial grants and carry a commercial name. 跟着这一句呢，就亦都刚才主任提过噶吓。 Members also doubted the need for continuing the scheme. The scheme 就系指嗰个城市基金咧， which was set up at the time of financial difficulties, and in view of the changed economic situation, suggested that TC should consider returning the unused fund to the government. 嗱呢句似乎咧就同专员刚才讲嘅系吻合咧，就意思就系话咧，其实系两个议题嚟嘅，一个就系关于有关。So
here there are two issues. One is about the guidelines on corruption prevention. Another point is that CPAC members doubted whether the MEF should continue given the changed economic situation. And the members went on to suggest that the Tourism Commission should return the unused funds to the government. So for CPAC members, or some of the members, they suggested that the unused funds should be returned to the government. Does it mean that it's just a general procedure, that is, unused funds should be returned to government as a general procedure, or is it that they thought the funds should be seized altogether? That's what they had in mind, and that's what we asked about last time. So that's why the funds should be returned to the government. So what's your understanding of that suggestion, Commissioner?
这一段呢, 一开头, In the beginning of this paragraph, it says that the CPAC had endorsed the CPAC report, and the report sole purpose is that if the MEF should continue, there were certain areas where anti-graft measures should be improved. And then it says, this paragraph continues. It says that the CPAC members suggested that in reviewing large funding and when commercial names are involved, the Tourism Commission should issue more stringent guidelines for staff. This indicates the effect of the CPAC report. That is, when the MEF continues, there are areas that need to be strengthened. And then it says, some members felt that the economic situation had changed and whether the TC should consider continuing the scheme. And this suggestion is not directly related to anti-graft. The focus was to implement anti-graft measures as soon as possible. We had considered these factors and the other factors I mentioned just now. You are aware that the FC had approved expanding the fund. The funds in the old scheme were returned to the Treasury. Well, to be fair, this is the first opportunity to read the 2010 November 15th ICAC letter. And one of the foci was on the TC or Economic and Treasury Bureau, where they asked for extra funding of $150 million. They did not mention the ICAC's suggestion. Now, to be fair, you're saying that ICAC is just preventing anti-graft measures, and they're mentioning as an aside that the economic situation has changed and whether the scheme needs to continue. So that's why in the FC you had not referred to the ICAC suggestion. Well, let me explain. The TC had explained very clearly. The CPAC prepares a lot of these kinds of reports for the government departments and institutions to implement anti-graft measures. Well, of course, the CPAC, well, my understanding is that they have different types of suggestions. The CPAC role on this occasion for the TC, they were just focused on the mega fund, whether anything monitoring could be done better. So of course, we will be focusing on the report and how they can tighten the monitoring and plug any potential loopholes. Well, this opinion, well, the MEF was established in 2009. The industry, LegCo, they had different views regarding MEF and whether it should continue in light of changing circumstances. Well, we felt that, did we need to continue operating mega events? We felt that that was not an anti-graft consideration. So when we did our review, as the commissioner said, we will consider this as a whole. Well, the whole letter, you have to look at it as a whole. We have four paragraphs in this letter. In paragraph 3, the CPAC, they say that if necessary, they were happy to give a presentation on corruption risk. So it's all about implementing anti-graft measures such that the MEF can meet the obligations of anti-graft. If the CPAC view is that there are too many loopholes, you can't plug all of them, so you should scrap the scheme. You would consider it seriously, but that's not their intention. They were saying that the economic situation had changed, and your attitude was that it's not your role, and therefore we're not going to consider that. No, in our response to the ICAC, we stated very clearly that the unused funds should be returned to the government. In our reply to the ICAC, we have explained that in considering the future of the MEF fund, we would consider it on that occasion. It's not that we neglected it, but this is really just a policy issue. Andrew, could you tell us which letter are you referring to? Annex D, handwritten, page 40. The horizontal, the landscape format document. Well, Chairman, this letter on 1st of February, it seems that you would implement the anti-graft measures, but you had not responded to whether the MEF should continue. Well, we said we would, in mid-2011, we would examine the way forward of the MEF on page 40, the last page. Well, I understand you asked ICAC to provide guidelines on anti-graft measures. You accepted and implemented their suggestions, but in the letter, as Paul Tier said, this is just a side response. You are responding ambiguously, saying that the administration will examine the way forward. This response indicates that you're not going to consider that. You were not going to consider that whether the MEF should continue at the time. So, for the Audit Commission, had you followed up and had you discussed with them? If you had, then why did you draft the report and give us the impression that this is part of the recommendation of the ICAC? Because one is a policy and one is just an assistance provided to the government's project. So could you give us an explanation? Well, Chairman, if you refer back to paragraph 1.11, the CPAC, the ICAC had concluded this report and provided the report to the advisory committee, and the advisory committee put forward two suggestions. One was implementation of the guidelines, and we had almost copied the contents of the letter verbatim and said we should take note of the operation of the MEF. We had had a internal discussion regarding the CPAC, and the CPAC being part of the ICAC framework. So we said that the ICAC had taken on board the CPAC views. We didn't make a clear distinction, and we had also had discussions with the Tourism Commission. So Assistant Commissioner, would she have anything to add? Well, thank you, Chairman. Paragraph 1.11, we had consulted the ICAC, and they suggested we draft it in such a manner. Well, you consulted them, but the purpose of inviting them and their suggestion, they're not directly related. Well, if they asked you to draft in such a manner, do you have a letter from them? Well, we need to deal with this in a fair manner. You need to indicate what happened. You are independent. You do not take instructions from the ICAC. We will issue criticism, but we need to have a basis for this criticism. We just want to discover the facts, and that is the spirit of the PAC. When we criticize them, we need to have the facts. Did the ICAC give you a letter? Well, after doing the audit, we had a draft report. We forwarded a copy to the Tourism Commission and the ICAC. It's because we had referred to the ICAC report, and the ICAC suggested we draft it in such a manner. They said a distinction wasn't required regarding the CPAC. They suggested a minor amendment. So that's what happened. So next, Kenneth. And then Wong Yuk Wan. You don't get upset. I asked you whether you wanted to speak, and you said no. Well, Mr. Wong Yuk Wan wants to speak first. The Chairman, regarding the MEF, the public have their own opinion. They should be scrapped. This MEF, whether it should be scrapped or not, the answer is the same after we receive this order. The ICAC recommendation also calls for scrapping the MEF. Oh, why are you putting up a fight? Now, if you look at the latest document, plus paragraph 1.11, actually I was going to focus on 1.11, the recommendation is very clear. You are trying to dodge the issue. You're saying, in light of economic situations, well, we don't have to rely on it. Two-thirds of visitors are from the mainland now. You can scrap this MEF. What have you done? What have you done to stimulate the economy? The individual travel scheme makes up two-thirds of travelers. The dragon lion dance attract mainlanders. So this MEF from 09 till now, the issues are very clear. Some people say criticize you of political considerations. They are continuing this MEF. Chen Gamlam is from the DAB. Wilson Koh from on the last occasion. You are just. It's a form of nepotism, but we are looking at it from the value for money perspective. You know, you're now benefiting Chen Gamlam. He is getting a lot of votes. He's getting a lot of sponsorship. Hear me out. We can't do anything about that. You have political considerations. That's why the ICAC report is ignored. Second, there are policy considerations. Your response is piecemeal. And the commissioner is also providing piecemeal explanation. The economy has improved. Initially, there were economic considerations you were given. How could you stimulate the economy with just a Manchester United soccer match? I told Lam Kin Fong that I couldn't get tickets. I couldn't get tickets from Jeffrey Lam. The public can't participate, but the government is footing the bill. So it should be scrapped. The economic considerations you answered, you disagree with the ICAC response. You can't explain why in 2012 an increase in funding, this report was not included, because you wouldn't get funding. Am I right?
I haven't finished. You let him answer. No, I haven't finished. Now, that was just the prelude. I'm coming to my questions now, Mr. Chairman. The Permanent Secretary said that he did think the ICAC's recommendation was for seizing the fund, but I think it was made clear that it is to return the unused funds to the government. Shouldn't that mean scrapping the fund, Permanent Secretary? In our letter to the committee, we made clear our views. I don't propose to repeat those points here. Now, Mr. Raymond Wong asked, in terms of policy, whether we should continue with the MEF. Now, we went to the Finance Committee, we went to the relevant panel for discussion. Yes, it's true, by then the economic situation changed, as the Chairman pointed out, but we also considered other factors, and that's why we proposed to the Finance Committee to inject more funds for us to continue with the MEF. It's finished. You let him finish. I'm the chairman. Let me chair the meeting, okay? Don't interject like that. Then I can't be the chairman. Okay, then. Have you finished with your answer? Mr. Chairman, we've explained this point already. The CPAC report, all the recommendations in the report have been implemented. Now, on whether we should continue with the MPF, there were various views expressed. We did take them into account, and we also took into account the views of the CPAC members. Well, now something's gone wrong. What of the recommendations did you consider? If you have followed the recommendations, we wouldn't have this problem now. Now, there were inappropriate behavior. Now it's become ICAC cases. The ICAC looked at the fund from the angle whether it would encourage corruption. But then you looked at it from another angle. You said, well, the economy has improved. But then because it's about using a commercial organization's name, and if you give money to people, you can't monitor how they use it. So what the ICAC said was definitely true. That is, this fund could easily lead to corruption, and that's what it has actually done. So you have not taken on board the views of the ICAC, and you kept saying that neighboring cities also spending a lot in staging major events. We need to keep our competitiveness, so that's why there's a need to keep the fund. But still, you could not address the ICAC's point about this fund leading to corruption. If you couldn't address that point, you should just fold up the scheme, because ICAC's position was clear. And when you apply for additional funding for the fund in 2012 at the Finance Committee, you did not mention ICAC's recommendation. So you have to answer that point. Mr. Chairman, just now the Commission explained that in our reply letter to the committee, we gave a clear explanation. But we do not accept that explanation. Can you now come up with a new explanation? Do you have a new explanation? Now, we are condemning you. You are so quick in response. So can you come up with a new explanation now? Because what you said, I don't accept. So I'm giving you a chance to give a new explanation. Now, whether we accept your explanation or not, but individually, of course, it's up to him to whether he accepts your recommendation. But do you have a new recommendation or new explanation? Can you answer that point? I think our explanation has been spelled out clearly in the letter. So can you briefly then go through your letter, paragraph 13, I think. If I could refer members to our paper. In our letter, Gen 4, paragraph 13, paragraph 12 and 13, and also 14. Can you please briefly explain it then? Because many didn't get a chance to read the letter, and of course, the public following the hearing haven't had a chance to read the letter too. We said in the letter that the assignment report had set out a series of recommendations on further enhancing the approval procedures and the monitoring system of the MEF. We spelled them out in a letter. In February 2011, the Tourism Commissioner replied to the Corruption Prevention Department on the implementation status of the recommendations. And paragraph 13 said that the report did not contain any recommendation on whether the MEF should be continued. When the CPD of the ICAC sent the report to the Tourism Commission in November 2010, it mentioned in a covering letter that members of the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee also doubted the need for continuing the MEF, which was set up at a time of financial difficulties and in view of the changed economic situation, suggested that the Tourism Commission should consider returning their used funds to the government. The Tourism Commission informed the Corruption Prevention Department that the government would examine the way forward for the MEF in 2011 and had indeed taken the said view into account when reviewing the way forward for the MEF in 2011. The conclusion of the review that was mentioned by the Commissioner, it was that Hong Kong's economic situation had indeed changed, but Hong Kong was facing fierce competition from neighboring cities in seeking to host mega events. In view of this, the Tourism Commission considered that the operation of the MEF should be extended, but that the scheme should be revised. So in our paper submitted to the Finance Committee in 2012, we explained the conclusion of the review. Our view then was that the report focused on the prevention of corruption through introducing more corruption prevention measures to the MEF. The recommendations have been put into practice. The suggestion by CPAC members for the Tourism Commission to consider returning the unused funds to the government contained in the CPD's letter was more a policy question and not related to corruption prevention. Nevertheless, the Tourism Commission has considered the relevant view in accordance with the suggestion. We therefore did not flag up the report nor the contents of the CPT's letter in the submission to the Finance Committee. Raymond, in the implementation of policy, host of problems popped up. Now, in this MEF in particular, it spurs corruption. That's an obvious issue. And ICAC doesn't just look at the corruption prevention angle, there's also the policy angle. Why is there a need for the fund? Now, they're not just saying that, well, you're not doing a proper job with corruption prevention and there's no need. No, that's not how they put it. The policy itself is rotten. The policy, this fund itself is rotten. That's why they ask you to stop. What you say now is pointless. Now, so you have used your own judgment. That's the point. You did not see the need to disclose the ICAC's suggestion when you sought extra funding from the Finance Committee. So that's your judgment, and you had to show the consequence for that judgment. Because that's why I must condemn you for that. That's the first point. I won't dwell on that because we all know what you've said. But you keep saying that there's a need to keep the fund, but the public don't think so. Now, my second point, 2.8 and 2.9. of the audit report. Paragraph. Rejected applications. Raymond, can we let other members ask about the ICAC? Do you have time? But if you don't have time, I'll let you ask your questions first. Okay, fine. Let others ask the questions because we want to finish with the ICAC part first. Next, Kenneth. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gen 14, NXD1, the ICAC letter, dated the 15th of November 2010. My reading of the second paragraph. There are four paragraphs in the letter. The second paragraph is the most important one, as you can see, Mr. Chairman. Just now, Mr. Wong said that shouldn't be a point covered by the reassignment report. Mr. Wong, did you say that? The chairman asked him, he didn't say it. So can you ask him, please? I asked him, he didn't answer me, but you can ask again. So, yes, Mr. Wong, please reply. Let me put the question again. In the second paragraph, there are just six lines. For this ICAC letter dated the 15th of November 2010 to the Tourism Commissioner, there are actually two points in this letter. Just now, Mr. Wong said that for the second point, that is...
兼等等等这句话呢，就并非原本你commission...
And, you know, for this point, that is for the 2011 September 30th report... That's the instruction. Did you ever say something like it's not the scope of that report? Now, in our reply, we said we did not ask for a suggestion as to whether the MEF should continue. So you mean in the assignment report? Yes, it's true, it's not in the assignment report, but then that report needs to be endorsed by the CPAC. Do you accept that as the fact? Yes, of course, that is the advisory committee. Of course, they will refer the reports to the advisory committee and seek their members' views. So one interpretation is just about returning the unused funds, but another interpretation is that the fund is so rotten, it's beyond redemption. Now, they have made a number of recommendations, and then you said later you've implemented all the implementations. Actually, all the recommendations, I'll come to that later as to whether you've actually implemented all the recommendations. But anyway, here, with what all that's happened and the improvement in the economy, so it was suggested that you stop the fund. That's another interpretation. And this whole paragraph, you know, it's consistent. Why must we highlight this point? If it's a by the way point, then the ICAC would not have highlighted this point in the cover letter. So that's my reading. What is your explanation, Mr. Wong? Well, actually, his question is the same as that put by Ms. Raymond. Well, Mr. Chairman, yes, you might say that's how you read this letter now. But the important point is that the Corruption Prevention Department looked at the operation of the MEF. If that was such an important recommendation, it should have been in the assignment report. But it's true, in the assignment report, there's never this point, and the Corruption Prevention Department never gave any view on this point to the government.
Mr. Wong, you feel that the recommendation is not serious enough? Are they recommended, for example, paragraph 33, monitoring business, documentary physical checks, paragraph 35, examination reports, the whole mechanism is failing. Well, I think it's very clear. It's not only there are flaws, a lot of work has not been done, plus this letter. Well, Chairman, I'm not sure whether we can we subpoena the minutes of the CPAC meetings? Can we? No, we have not looked at that. Well, if we have such a need, we can do so in the closed meeting. But they've made it very clear. We can continue. We don't need to look at their minutes. This letter is very clear. This is a concluding remark. The advisory committee has come to a suggestion. It's just a matter whether the administration accept or not. We don't need to look at the minutes. We don't need to go into detail. I accept your suggestion, Sharon. In this regard, I have parallel views with Mr. Wong Yuk-man. Thank you. We can include these in our report next, Mr. Allen, now. So let's focus on this paper. When the PAC pro-government camp, they are blatantly speaking on behalf of the government, I think the best evidence we have is that we struck them at we struck the raw nerve. Well, I want to confirm in the witness testimony we heard just now whether it's the Commissioner for Tourism or Permanent Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. They have confirmed the letter in Gen 14, paragraph 2, mentioned the CPAC member meeting. There were members that suggested that it was not necessary to continue the MEF. It was not neglected. This view was not ignored. I would like to hear, is that the truth, Permanent Secretary? We had, in 2011 review, we had considered that. I don't want to waste the witness's time. That's okay. We also see, as the Permanent Secretary had referred us to their response in the table, that is Gen 4, Gen 14, the last page, the last table. The administration will examine the way forward of the MEF in mid-2011. So whether it is Gen 14 or today's oral testimony, we have confirmed that the CPAC suggestion had been taken on board. the Commissioner for Tourism said that regarding the way forward of the MEF, there was consideration. The testimony is clear. On the last occasion, I had pointed out on 27th of April, 2011, there was a funding request for the MEF. The Finance Committee had reasonable expectation that all relevant facts and opinions, especially the ICAC views, should be disclosed in the FC, especially when you see from the oral and document testimony that the government had considered this opinion. Of course, the government will have their own conclusion. It's permitted. But the LegCo FC can have different conclusions. But if you were to ignore this as if it never existed, that is a dereliction of duty. We are now considering how much emphasis you're putting on this suggestion. So I want to give the witnesses an opportunity to respond. In the Gen 14 letter and through the Commissioner for Tourism and Permanent Secretary witness testimony, can you tell the PAC that this ICAC view is irrelevant? Chairman, the ICAC CPAC view was that times have economic situation has changed and whether we should consider the need for the MEF to continue. In 2011, a review, this had been considered, and in the document submitted to the FC, we state very clearly that we suggest continuing the MEF because of other reasons. So, Chairman, I am fully aware we're being asked why in the LegCo document we didn't include that information. But this suggestion, it had been considered. And when we submitted reasons to FC, we had stated that. Well, the PS, if you had considered that, you should have written that. The chairman, allow me to follow up. Well, the permanent secretary said the government had considered, the government considers it necessary. Well, then why do you think the FC doesn't need to consider that? So that's not logical. So I'm pointing out to the PS that as an executive arm, they feel that it is necessary and needs to be considered. That means the FC also needs to consider it because it's relevant. But given this condition, they had not mentioned a word. I think that is deliberate. You are deliberately hiding the recommendation of the ICAC. The fact is that it's not written, but I disagree that we had deliberately covered it up. Well, of course, the conclusion of whether it was a deliberate cover-up, it's up to us. I'm just giving you an opportunity for you to state your case. I have already pointed out the illogical response. Because the executive arm feels that it's important and had considered that, then why, on 27th of April 2011, in the FC committee application for $150 million, why did you think that the FC did not need to consider this information? And you didn't give us this background information. How could we consider? We weren't even aware. So on this basis, I'm pointing out to you and I'm giving you the opportunity to respond. I'm saying you had a deliberate cover-up. Mr. the Commissioner for Tourism, we need to state clearly once again, we did not deliberately cover up any information because we understand submitting documents to FC, they have to be accurate. So we had absolutely not deliberately hid any information. I want to explain to you that the ICAC-CPAC study focus was on implementing their suggestions. We did that. The recommendation to FC for expanding and extending the MEF, the consideration at the time was that we, even though the economic situation has changed, but in light of what our competitors were doing, we wanted to maintain our competitiveness. So that was the focus in the FC document regarding not mentioning the CPAC views. In fact, we did not mention that, but it was not a deliberate, premeditated cover-up. Well, we don't understand. If you had considered that an important point, and there's so much back and forth communication, then why on the 27th of April, FC meeting, why didn't you explain that? Well, set aside whether it was deliberate, why didn't you include that information? Why didn't you include that information for the FC's why didn't you include it for their information? Our job is to monitor the government's work. So why was this important document omitted? Well, if it's not deliberate, then it must be a neglect of duty. Well, you write a lot of documents to LegCo. Things should be very clear. When you received this letter, the Gen 4 letter, if you disagreed, then you should have written back. And you should have indicated you had a policy and their response was not in line with the policy, but in Gen 14, the last paragraph in Gen 14 said it was an ambiguous response saying that you would consider that. So anybody who looks at it, it indicates that you might have considered, but you have not told the FC that you disagreed. I'll give you an opportunity to explain because the PAC will have to draft its report. We have the authority, but we rely on the facts. You didn't give us a good explanation. On why you acted in a certain way. We're not going to decide whether you are right or wrong. Chairman, as a matter of courtesy, when they provided the CPAC views, well, as you said, whether we had to say whether it was relevant to ICAC or not, well, as a matter of courtesy, we'll take note of what was mentioned. And we had already planned a review in 2011. So the view at the time was that this matter and the CPAC members' views could be dealt with in 2011. So whether we would say that it was relevant to ICAC or not, we would not respond because even when a public writes to us, we will consider their views. Well, but as a matter of courtesy, you need to explain why their view was not in line with your policy. They're not a general public. At that time, It was in 2010, and our review was in 2011. So we responded by saying, in the future review, we would consider this. Alan, the ICAC views, of course, cannot be compared with a layperson's. I hope that's not your intention, because if that is the case, it is not respectful of the ICAC. And you're also underestimating the PAC. Chairman, for record's sake, allow me to state clearly, the ICAC view is related to the future of the MEF.
The administration, on receipt of Gen 14, that is the ICAC letter dated the 15th of November 2010. Now, how the administration treated the letter goes to show that this suggestion is definitely relevant to the future of the MEF, whether it's to be scrapped or to stay. Now, in the documents submitted by the administration to the Finance Committee, there's no mention of this suggestion whatsoever. So what I'd like to point out to the Permanent Secretary is this. Now, how much weight we would give to that suggestion, that's our prerogative. That's what the chairman said too. So it's not for the administration to decide for us that this is not important, irrelevant, and so on. So either you did so deliberately, or either there was gross negligence. If it's negligence, that's easy. That is, there's something you should have done and you didn't do, that means there's negligence. So I'm giving the witness the last chance now. If you are to challenge what I just said, that is, the ICAC's view is relevant to the future of the ICAC, of the MEF. So either you challenge the ICAC, or either you were deliberate, so either you were negligent. So can you respond to my statement? In our reply to the Secretariat, we said that we made a judgment on that at that time. And the view was considered in our review. And in the Finance Committee paper, we gave the reasons why we saw the need to continue with the fund. Do you have anything else, Mr. Alan Long? Well, ICAC is not just any Tom, Dick, or Harry. We are talking about value for money study now. But and the audit has confirmed that the MEF could be an avenue for transfer of benefits, and it's the hotbed for corruption. So that's why you simply cannot ignore the views of the ICAC. Mr. Mleung Singh, well, these days everything is there's possibility of this and that. So going by what Mr. Alan Leung just said, so we are extending our doubts. Now, PAC at the public hearing is an important venue for taking evidence. So we have to see whether there's evidence pointing to something. Gen 4, paragraph 13, the assignment report of the ICAC did not contain any specific recommendation on whether the MEF should be continued. But there's mention that some members of the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee held that view. So when we read documents or information, we have to be sure. We can't just rely on guesswork. If It's just some members who had their views, just like today at the PAC, different members have different views. Mr. Leung may hold this view, Paul may hold another view, and I may hold my own view too. So if such views are reflected, does it mean that at the time when they received the assignment report, that view was one of the conclusions of the report, or was it a conclusion of the ICAC? So you had to change some of your practices or even policies. Can you please answer that question, Mr. Wong? Our view was, of course, as spelled out in a reply letter to the Secretariat. Now, this is not a view directly related to corruption prevention. It's a view on the policy. Is it not a conclusion? Well, then, I have to ask you to read the letter of the ICAC. I note that the wordings used by the ICAC are different. In some parts of the letter, in English, the term used is recommended. And they also used another term, suggested. Yeah, they said members, plural. We don't know if it's all the members, or it's definitely not just one member because it's plural. So some members, in other words, suggested that. But does it mean that it's their conclusion, it's the conclusion of the report? If it's recommend, that means there are some members who recommended that, but it's not a suggestion, it's not a conclusion, it's not a requirement. Could you see it that way? Mr. Chairman, can I answer the question? Yes, please. Now, our reading at the time was that if it was a formal recommendation of the Corruption Prevention Department, it would have been in the report, but it was not in the report. Okay, that point is made clear. So we want to confirm whether the Tourism Commissioner did not implement the guidelines or requirements of the ICAC. Now, if it's a suggestion and not a conclusion, and also it's a suggestion on policy, now, does the ICAC have the power to correct your policies? Well, I'm sure we will have our understanding about that, and I'm sure the Audit Commission would also note what the functions and role of the ICAC are. That is, whether ICAC should advise you to take the money back and whether it's directly related to corruption prevention. I think there is division of labor and delineation of functions there. Audit Commission, anything to add, please? In paragraph 1.11, we made it clear, or we described clearly, on whether the Corruption Prevention Department considered whether the fund should continue. I think we have given an accurate description in 1.11. Well, Mr. Ng, just now you asked a question. The Permanent Secretary replied to it. The report was compiled by the Corruption Prevention Department, but the letter was from the ICAC to the Permanent Secretary. So then that's the committee. So these two separate issues. The committee studied and endorsed the report, and then the committee made a suggestion. So those are two separate issues. But of course, both have to do with the MEF. Now we have to make that clear. Now, Alan Leung just now asked a question. I think for those who follow this hearing, I want to make sure that they know what we're talking about because they haven't read the papers. Just now, the Permanent Secretary only answered the part about the report of the Corruption Prevention Department. But on top of the report, there's suggestions from the committee, which is not in the report. Am I right to put it that way. Thank you for filling in the background, Mr. Chairman. But here we're just talking about paragraph 1.11 of the audit report. Yes, paragraph 1.11, that's a separate issue. Correct? Audit Commission. So we have to get the facts right. If you just read the report, you wouldn't know it. That's why we have a hearing, and then people would know what the facts really are. So please continue, Mr. Gen 4, paragraph 13. It says here, some members proposed or advanced this point about the changed economic situation, but then later on in the paragraph you explained that you reviewed the operation of the MEF. Now, is that the view of the entire department? That is, there was a fierce competition from neighboring cities in seeking to host mega events. That's why the Tourism Commission considered that the operation of the MEF should be extended. So that means you did consider that point, you've come to some conclusion, right? And that's the decision of a department of the government, is that correct? Yes, Mr. Chairman. If that's the case, audit report, paragraph 1.11. So whether the unused funds should be returned to the government, actually here it says the ICC raised its concern with the need for continuing the MEF, which was set up at a time of financial difficulties and in view of the changed economic situation, suggested that the Tourism Commission should consider returning the unused funds to the government. Mr. Ng, this point was answered. Now the fund ceased, so they had to return the funds in any case before they apply for another $150 million. That's how it was. Now, but if you link it up together, that is, they need to improve upon the guidelines. 1.11 says that after presenting the assignment report to its Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee, the ICAC further recommended that the Tourism Commission should issue more stringent guidelines for its staff in evaluating events that involved substantial grants and carried a commercial name. So here it's just about a specific part of the operation. It's not that for all the entire operation there has to be a need for more stringent guidelines. So did you follow the recommendation? Permanent Secretary? So there are two phases to the fund. During the first phase, when it ended, perhaps you could explain it. I think it was in March 2014, and when the fund ceased then, the fund ended, right? You've only spent $47 million, so you have to return the unused funds in any case. But then on the 17th of April, you came back to the Finance Committee for $150 million. So can you please explain the Tier 2? You mean Phase Tier 2? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You're right. For the old fund, on the 31st of March 2012, the fund expired. And then we went back to the Finance Committee in April 2012 to apply for funding for the amended Mega Events Fund. And on the Corruption Prevention Department's recommendations to us, that is, we should issue more stringent guidelines for our colleagues to evaluate events involving substantial grants and which carry a commercial name. That's the recommendation of the report, and together with other recommendations in the assignment report, they've been included in our work procedure.
有个相关性呢, 就是说,
because the two parts are related, there need to be more stringent assessment when granting the funding. It doesn't mean that there was improprieties and therefore you should scrap the fund. So did you have a consideration, and it was because there were suspicions and therefore it should have been scrapped? So was that part of your discussion? Well, we had said just now, the CPAC, in doing the study, their report had also said, after the fund had started operating, there were anti-graft measures in place. In the CPAC report, they never said that the MEF had serious graft problems. The focus of the report was that in light of anti-graft measures in place, were there any opportunities for improvement and efficiency? That was the focus. The report never said that from day one there were serious problems. We understand that. But we also understand that this report was submitted to the CPAC. They identified so many problems. They felt that in 2012, 31st of March, the MEF should expire. And they said it should expire and the unused funds should be returned to the government. You're now only responding to one part. Our legislators are saying why on 17th of April 2012 you didn't state the facts. We need to understand the comings and goings when we draft our report. So do you need to submit other information that hasn't been disclosed and that we require? Paul, do you need to ask any questions? I'll stop and enter the... I think this is sufficient. Did you raise your hand? I don't have any questions, and during the questioning, I was reading Gen 5, 6, 7. I'll focus on those parts. Allow me some follow-up, and we'll draw a line here. Chairman, I'd like to understand. The letter on 1st of February, the Tourism Commission responded back to the ICAC.
我想理解一下當時的而且確呢就
The MEFAC was made aware. Could the AC chairman tell us what did you know about the ICAC recommendations? Jeffrey Lam, the ICAC report was not submitted to the committee for discussion. Could you answer why it wasn't made available for discussion? Thank you, Chairman. The Secretary of the MEF on the 2nd of December 2010 had submitted documents to the MEF. It's Assignment 36-2010. We had listed the recommendations for the MEFAC for their information. We had also reported that we would implement these ICAC CPAC report contents. It was noted and there was a discussion. by August 2011, the Tourism Commission, they were conducting the review, and we had taken the review progress and reported to the MEFAC. In that review document, we had included the 2011 1st of February ICAC CPAC letter. We had responded how would we implement the anti-graft measures, and we also included their suggestions in that document. Paul, well, we have consensus that anti-graft measures and suggestions and implementation of anti-graft, we're now talking about the second half. Anti-graft, aside from anti-graft, there are members' views that the economic situation has changed and whether the funds should be returned to the government. I want to focus on that part. At any time, did the TC or have any explanation to the MEFAC or had mentioned the CPAC recommendations regarding unused funds? Rosanna, I had already responded just now regarding the discussions. We don't have minutes, so I cannot respond to Mr. Paul J. accurately that what we had discussed. Well, did you mention ICAC Gen 4 letter? Some members had said that the MEF should expire, should shut down. Was that mentioned? We're not asking about records. We're just asking you a simple question. If you can't recall, then you can go refer to your documents. Well, I don't have the relevant records, so I cannot answer right now. Well, the Gen 14 ICAC 15 November 2010 letter. At any stage, did you provide this to the MEFAC? No, in my recollection, we don't have, but I can check the records. Well, Jeffrey, did you see this letter? We had discussed the way forward. Well, please answer the question. Gen 14 had mentioned the way forward. We're talking about the ICAC, CPAC recommend, asked you to consider to return the funds and scrap the MEF. Have you heard them explain this to you? No, not in my recollection. Well, you could check your records and respond later. Paul? Well, simple question. Why not? Why didn't you submit it to members, MEFAC members? Not anti-graft, but way forward. Economic conditions change, and whether the MEF should be scrapped. Will the commissioner or anyone else respond? Well, this morning we had repeated that in handling the CPAC report, it was just solely on anti-graft. And even later, the MEFAC discussions, initial discussion before the talks about way forward, the talks were still focusing on anti-graft measures. Ms. Law, anything you would like to add? I'd like to remind you, Paul's question is quite important because in Annex A1, in Gen R62, Stroke 3, Stroke Gen 1, Annex A1, page 6, regarding the assessment committee. The terms of reference are very clear. Advise on to make recommendations to the Permanent Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development as to advise the Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development on the use of the Mega Events Fund. So they need to respond to your bureau. But the CPAC letter, it was very hard for them to implement. That's why Paul was saying, why didn't you submit it to them? Could you explain? Because we need to look at the whether they, it was beyond the terms of reference. If it was within the terms of reference, then why didn't they submit that letter? Yes, that's correct. Well, as I said, aside from the focus on anti-graft measures, the economic situation had changed whether the MEF should continue. Of course, that was the CPAC members' views, but not part of the report, and it was also not their overall stance. Well, Chairman, I think the focus in the paragraph 14 of Gen 4, you had attempted to explain the funding exercise with FC or and the Economic Services Panel, aside from anti-graft measures, why you didn't mention the other suggestion. You said, I won't read it out. You're saying that that the focus was on anti-graft, and whether the fund should continue as a policy question and not related to corruption prevention. So in the FC, you did not flag up the report nor the contents of the CP's letter in the submission to the Finance Committee. You said there was no flag up, no warning, but if you did mention that, or this being a policy issue, and therefore weight shouldn't be attached to the CPAC report, and if there was discussion in the FC, there would be no problem. But now, you're being questioned that why in FC or Economic Services Panel you did not flag up this at all. So nobody could ask you questions and there was no discussion. So I'll give you a last opportunity. Is there, aside from paragraph, this response in paragraph 40, do you have any other response? Permanent Secretary, in paragraph 14, we had set out the government. In the government review, there were changes in the economic situation and other reasons submitted to the FC and relevant panel. We had stated our reasoning. Well, you did not mention the ICAC opinion, and you didn't say that even though economic situation has changed, and as the tourism commissioner said, other competitors were also hosting events. Well, am I correct that you didn't mention the ICAC report? Yes, we had stated in the document that we didn't mention the ICAC report. Okay. I just want to follow up on Paul's questions originating from his line of questioning.
I'd like to refer the witness to Annex D2. So the then tourism commissioner wrote this letter to the head head of the Corruption Prevention Department, right? This letter. Paragraph 2. Just now, Mr. Pawsey already referred to that.
That the MEF Assessment Committee has been informed about the study carried out by the ICAC. 那好了,我想问一下,这里所指的...
So may I ask, this MEFAC has been informed. Has been informed of what and when has it been informed? Could you produce records to pertinent to this fact? On the 1st of February 2011, or rather in the 2010 December 12th, we set out all recommendations of the assignment report number 30/2010 to the assessment committee. Which part of, or is it just recommended? Perhaps you could, let me lead the witness. So are you referring to the document, you know, the handwritten page number from 3 all the way to 33, I think? So from pages 3 to 33, this entire report, did you submit it to the MEFAC? Deputy Commissioner? Mr. Chairman, I said just now all the recommendations in the report were fully reported to the MEFAC. So in other words, you did not actually submit the assignment report to the MEFAC. Mr. Chairman, I have already said what I said. What have you said? We need to... A record, Deputy Commissioner, this is a solemn forum. This is a verbatim evidence-taking process. You're a witness. So what exactly did you say? Now, he's asking you about the report from pages 3 to 33. Is it a full all the pages, or is it just part of the some of the pages that you explained to the assessment committee? So from page 9, let us refer to Gen 14, the report starts from page 9. So is it from starting from this page, you give it to the MEFAC? If you haven't done so, no need. Well, you just say no. If you have submitted the report to them, which part of the report? Because my question was clear and specific. Can I repeat my question, Mr. Chairman? Mr. Chairman, we did not submit the report to the MEFAC, but we passed on the recommendations in the report to the MEFAC. So can you please give us a document? When you gave the information to the assessment committee, that paper, can you just give to us? Yes, we could do that. Follow up, please, Mr. Chairman. Gen 14. The letter dated the 15th of November 2010 from ICAC. Did you submit this letter to the MEFAC? Do you know which letter? Yes, I do. So can you please answer the question? No. Mr. Jeffrey Lam, Chairman of the Assessment Committee. Just now, Mr. Lam said that the MEFAC did consider, and I quote, the way forward. So this consideration that is on the way forward for the MEF, when did that happen? Do you recall, Mr. Lam? I do not recall the exact date, but when we discussed how the MEF should operate in the future, we had more than one discussion. For example, the review on the stringent criteria for the applications. And we also discussed the new Tier 1 mechanism. So the discussion covered many aspects. audit, did you review the documents of the assessment committee? If so, could you share some information with us? Yes, Mr. Chairman, we did review the documents. Yes, so you reviewed the documents. In that case, Tourism Commissioner, can you please give us the minutes of the meetings of the assessment committee as to when they discussed the matter, okay? Alan? Tourism Commissioner, perhaps as part of the evidence, you can tell us this. The MEF Assessment Committee, chaired by Mr. Lam. Now, when the government came to apply for $150 million from the Finance Committee at that time, have you concluded your discussion on whether the MEF should stay? Permanent Secretary or Commissioner? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In August 2011, we submitted a paper to the MEF Assessment Committee on the way forward for the MEF. So in 2011, you submitted or raised the item with the Assessment Committee for discussion. And then in 2012, when the administration came to the Finance Committee to apply for funding injection, now this Assessment Committee chaired by Mr. Lam, now it has it completed the discussion of the future of the MEF? In August 2011, that was before we asked for funding from the Finance Committee. So I've completed taking evidence on this part. So can I ask, why is it so strange if you have any respect for the Assessment Committee, and in particular the Chairman, Mr. Jeffrey Lam, at all? For this recommendation of the ICAC dated the 15th of November 2020, and even if it's just a recommendation of some members, how come you did not forward this recommendation to the Chairman, Mr. Jeffrey Lam, for consideration? Is it the case that you just screened out things for him? So what's your mentality? What's the logic for this approach, Commissioner? On the Corruption Prevention Department report, definitely our focus was on corruption prevention. Was it not related? Can I remind the Commissioner? Just now the Chairman pointed out to you the Assessment Committee led by Mr. Lam. What is terms of references? It certainly includes all matters. And you should know that there is this suggestion coming from a corruption prevention body. And now we see the problems. That's exactly because this is a hotbed for corruption. This is a platform for transferring benefits. If you do not submit that piece of information to Mr. Lam, then you make the matter even more serious and you try to cover it up from the LESCO. That's serious. And Mr. Lam is supposed to be the gatekeeper. He's supposed to advise you. So do you regard the Assessment Committee as a rubber stamp? Is that how the way the executive or CY Lam works? That's your view. Now, I want to give them a chance to reply to this because we have to include it in the report. I'm just being fair, right? The Assessment Committee, when it considered the way forward for the MEF, I'm sure it must have taken into consideration all factors. Now, for example, the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee's suggestion was that the economic situation changed. Was there a need to continue with the fund? So, as the Assessment Committee considered the future of the MEF as to whether it should be kept on a long-term basis, I'm sure the Assessment Committee must have taken this factor into account. On that day, we did not make specific mention of this view expressed by the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee, because at the time we formed the judgment that we were to discuss the future of the entire fund and whether there was need to continue with it. If we wanted to continue with it, what the reasons were. But our question is about the assessment committee having the right to know. Now, if the assessment committee was not aware of the letter dated the 15th of November 2010, they wouldn't know how others view them. And here, these others aren't just any person in the street. Here, we're talking about the advisory committee's suggestion. So the assessment committee has the right to know about that. So that's why we're asking you, how come then you made this decision, first of all, not to submit the ICAC report to the assessment committee, and secondly, why you did not give the assessment committee the ICAC letter? These are two straightforward questions. And why are we asking these questions? It's because in the terms of reference of the assessment committee, it has the power to do that because it is your advisory committee is to assess. The terms of reference of the assessment committee is such that it has to perform this task. First point, the study of the Corruption Prevention Department and its recommendations. Well, it's true we did not submit the entire document to the assessment committee, but we did prepare paper to explain all the recommendations given and how they should be implemented. So we did give an account to the assessment committee. Second part of your question, at a time, as we discussed with the assessment committee on the future of the MEF and whether it should continue, now we did not mention specifically this view previously expressed by the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee. But on the point of the economy having changed, I'm sure this point was considered by the assessment committee. A quick point, Mr. Chairman. You refer to Gen 1 NXA1, the terms of reference of the assessment committee. Can I clarify a certain issue? Because some of the questions are critical. This assessment committee. Now, at a different point, the chairman used the word advisory, but actually it's just an assessment. It's an assessment committee. So the chairman of the assessment committee, the permanent secretary, or the commissioner. In your view, the terms of reference of the assessment committee, is it based on the first point, that is on the use of the mega events fund, right? So it's just about the use of the event funds. On whether the fund should continue, does it really fall within the terms of reference of the assessment committee? Paul, I use the term advisory because it's part three of the terms of reference to advise on any matters. So I just want to clarify this point. Now I can see for paragraphs 1 and 2, but is it about the use of the megafunds and the assessment of applications, or more importantly, whether the MEF should stay or not, is it within the terms of reference of the assessment committee? Permanent Secretary, the primary function of the assessment committee is, of course, to assess the use of the mega events funds. That means applications and the approval of vetting of applications. That's the main function of the assessment committee. But on the MEF, if there is need to consult the assessment committee on anything, we will still consult them. But of course, at the end of the day, the decision is to be made by the administration. Now, paragraph 3 says to advise on any other matters. What does that include? Like, for instance, whether we want to continue with the fund, we will listen, we will seek the views of the assessment committee, but of course, it's a policy decision, it will be made by the administration. So on whether the fund should be continued and you will seek the views of the assessment committee, how come then you did not provide the assessment committee with the ICAC letter dated the 15th of November 2010? Now, as I explained before, The reason why the suggestion was made by the CPAC members were that the economic situation had changed, so was there a need to continue with the fund? So as we consider whether we should continue with the fund internally, we did take that point into account. Well, times change, and even the public question whether we should keep the MEF, everybody talks about it. And then here we're not talking about just any Tom, Dick, or Harry making this suggestion, or even individual electrical members which you do not care much about. Here we're talking about the ICC. This is part of the establishment. This is a specific suggestion. Somehow you never thought it necessary to inform the assessment committee of this suggestion. Now, since you respect the views of the assessment committee, shouldn't you have informed them of this suggestion? Now, you said the report is just about corruption prevention, but and it's not within the scope of that report. But still, they mentioned the changes in the economic circumstances, so shouldn't that be considered? Now, we've asked that several times. Is it because it doesn't fall within the professional ambit of the CAC? That's why you didn't think it was important?
The CPAC focus was to provide views on anti-graft measures. So if it's about anti-graft measures, we will implement those measures very seriously, and we'll also respond whether we had implemented those measures. Now, CPAC, they have other policy views. We have a lot of deputations, LegCo members, or advisory committee members who have different views on policies. So when documents are drafted for committees, I accept that these are not layperson views, but I need to mention that the CPAC members, their major task is to provide views on anti-graft measures. So our judgment at that time was that this was not an anti-graft measure. So regarding the substance of their view, that is, the economic conditions had changed, we had considered that. Well, Secretary, you also need to bear in mind that their suggestion was not just about a change in economic situation. As one said, they were of the opinion that a lot of things occurred but shouldn't have occurred, and no matter what measures you had, the problem still exists. And they were suggesting that the fund should be scrapped. So this is the line of reasoning we're adopting. You can demonstrate your way of thinking. Chairman, we're referring to 2010 when CPAC submitted this view. In 2010, they suggested strengthening the monitoring of the fund. The report did not say that there were serious problems with the fund. Chairman, we'll allow one more question. I just recalled that the assistant, the audit commissioner, assistant audit commissioner, said there were some changes in the ICAC records. Before you answer, could you answer my question? I'm also referring to 1.11. You said that the advisory committee recommended that the TC should And then later on you said at the ICAC level, a high level. You didn't refer to the advisory committee. You said ICAC. So it goes beyond just the advisory committee level. It carries a heavier weight. Could you explain that? In paragraph 1.11, it was very clear, CPAC, the advisory committee, the ICAC, the commissioner emailed us and suggested he didn't want it to be read just as an assignment report for the advisory committee. His suggestion was that it should be the ICAC's view. Now, even though the audit report and work process, there are a lot of amendments in the wording, but ultimately we had weighed taken on board the CPAC comments. So when we compiled this report, we used ICAC to replace the CPAC because the CPAC is an important part of the ICAC. So if they held that view or suggestion, so we used a more generic term. We're not criticizing their suggestion, but the fact is, after compiling your report, is it because the ICAC commissioner made that recommendation? Well, you have to look at the facts. If it was discussed at the ICAC senior level, but if it was just considered within the CPAC, then it should reflect the CPAC's view. For example, if it's the PAC view, it's just the PAC. We cannot represent the whole Legislative Council. So we have no questions with the CPAC report, but I just want to clarify. What changed? Where was the authority to make this change? Well, Chairman, I think the answer from the Assistant Commissioner and the Audit Commissioner's response, we already got the answer. I might have misunderstood. The witness can clarify. What I hear from the commissioner and assistant commissioner is that paragraph 1.11 have stated very clearly that it's the ICAC, CPAC's view, but when the draft was submitted to ICAC, the commissioner for ICAC suggested this current wording. So that's the way they drafted. That's what I heard. If it's not the case, the witness can clarify. I'm also referring to this paragraph. If you look at the wording, the audit commission had explained very clearly. They had shown a copy to the ICAC, and ICAC is accountable. They're taking full responsibility. If you look at the wording, look at the English. After presenting the assignment report to its Corruption Prevention Committee, the ICAC further recommended that the TC should issue more stringent guidelines for its staff in evaluating events that involve substantial grants and carried a commercial name. So it's ICAC. Furthermore, the ICAC raised its concerns with the need for containing the MEF. It's not referring to the report. It's not referring to the CPAC. It's the ICAC. It's very clear. The Audit Commission also responded clearly. Where is the difference? They're telling you this is the ICAC view. You don't, you're impatient. You don't hear us out. There's plenty of time. We can continue. So this paragraph is very clear. ICAC is telling you to shut down. It's the ICAC view. You can't manage graph. Well, you are I want them to explain. Your question is, why is there an IFZ committee and then it was escalated to ICAC level? So they give you an explanation. I'm asking, we have procedures and regulations. I already said the we need to draft a report. You can hear them out, but we need to discover the facts. Thank you, Chairman. Let me add that ICAC came back with their version. We would see whether it was acceptable. I had discussed with the Commissioner and felt that the CPAC is part of the ICAC in terms of organizational framework. So we need, that's why we have to see whether there was another meeting. Well, that explanation is sufficient. It's Chairman, they have stated clearly they want to accept the ICAC view. They have to be accountable. They explain. Well, if I didn't ask, they wouldn't. Well, don't argue. They've already explained. To be fair, Gen 14 Annex D1. Nelson Chan, Director of Corruption Prevention, ICAC, he said that CPAC members made a recommendation. It's very clear that committee members made a recommendation. It's not the whole ICAC. But in the Audit Commission report, we need to clarify well, if you look at the assignment, 2010, 30th of September, they made a recommendation. This whole assignment, what needed to be endorsed by the CPAC, that's at a higher level. So do you agree this advisory committee under the ICAC ordinance, this is a very important committee. I've never doubted that. So in the second paragraph, it says the CPAC members that TC should issue more stringent guidance. So it's the same as ICAC. I disagree with Paul's interpretation. We now can discover the truth. We're not debating Mr. Kenneth Leung said that the recommendation itself did not mention, because this is a change in economic situation, the money had to be returned to the government. The 15 November letter says that CPIC members, well, that's very clear. I believe, let's clarify the facts first. The Audit Commission will agree. They agree. We're trying to discover the facts, and whatever conclusion you draw from the facts, that's your decision. So I recommend that the Audit Commissioner and the ICAC Commissioner, regarding paragraph 1.11, their communication be submitted to the PAC. And after our scrutiny, in order to satisfy Chairman's doubts, we might need to ask the ICAC Commissioner why he made such a recommendation. Because your question, I don't think the Audit Commissioner can answer that. Because he has to consider the ICAC Commissioner's views. So the Audit Commissioner and Assistant Audit Commissioner have reasons for accepting the ICAC Commissioner views. But if you want to know why he made such a suggestion, I think you'll have to ask the ICAC. Let me respond why I want to ask that question. So every word in the report leads to a lot of questions and discovery of the facts. I'm not blindly accepting. If they can explain the facts, the commissioner is also bound by rules and regulations. They can't write whatever they want. The report had been submitted to the advisory committee in paragraph 1.11. You stated clearly it was the advisory committee, and then it was upgraded to the ICAC level. And Kenneth Leung stated clearly it's a different level. And I want them to explain why was there such a change. And they said that the ICAC commissioner made the suggestion. But I need to raise a question. The ICAC commissioner, why did he have that recommendation? It will affect our report. I said I accepted the report, and then it was upgraded to ICAC level. So we need to understand the rationale behind.
Kenneth, let me fine-tune what you said. Paragraph 1.11 is always about the ICAC. It never said that it's the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee. In Chinese, it says the ICAC in bracket further recommended that the Tourism Commission should. So it's the ICAC's recommendation. And then line 3, furthermore, the ICAC raised this concern. We must read the ordinance again. Is it the case that the ICAC must follow all the recommendations of the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee? If that's the case, then the views of the CPAC would be the views of the ICAC. Now, you are the independent executive directors of many companies. You know that when auditors do audit for a company, they would very much rely on the director's recommendations. I'm sure you have made such recommendations before. The ICAC commissioner and the director of audit, they have correspondences, and that's direct representation. If there is no suspicious situation, and if it's the professional judgment of the director of audit, we have no reason not to believe the ICAC commissioner and the director of audit both are independent professional bodies. You know, we have no reason not to believe in what they said. Yes, that's right. That's why we have to ask questions. I have not negated their recommendation. I just want to clarify that. Yes, I need to clarify that too. I know that, understand. That's why I asked how come they use ICAC, but at the beginning they used a corruption advice prevention advisory committee. That's why I have to ask them. You can't just take whatever they write. Let me finish. I just want to clarify some facts. There's no need to be nervous or angry. Now, what Kenneth Leung said is that you misread the paragraph. Listen to me. It's the ICAC who presented the assignment report to the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee. It's not that the CPAC made a suggestion to the ICAC to scrap the fund. No, don't get it wrong. No, I haven't got it wrong. It's not a CPAC which asked the MEF to fold up, but rather it's after the ICAC presented the assignment report to the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee, then the committee suggested the fund should just be scrapped. Now, this is clearly spelled out. I'm not trying to defend them. You're right to ask why they accepted the ICAC's recommendation. No, please refer to Gen 1 or Gen 4, or Gen 14, D1. In the letter, it says advisory members. So you have to do your homework. You can't just say whatever you like. There are facts to go by. And from that letter, we see that there are CPAC members, not ICAC, sorry, okay? It's the members are of the advisory committee. Now, I'm not talking about the letter. I'm talking about this paragraph. If you read that letter and then you read this paragraph, you see difference. So as the chairman as well, I have the duty to ask questions. I'm not like you. I'm not here to argue with you, so don't target me. I'm talking about the issue. I'm not targeting you. I dare not target you. I'm talking about issues. Stop targeting me. You said I haven't read the documents. Of course I have. I'm just saying in this paragraph, this is a paragraph in the report, and it stated very clearly that there's ICAC's review, and that's the overall views of the ICAC. Oh, you finished, Raymond. Next, Kenneth, or Paul, and then Paul. Let's go back to the letter dated the 15th of November, just the small paragraph. In the English version, it says here, CPAC members for both points. That includes issue more stringent guidelines. And the way you read it, issue more stringent guidelines for staff in invalidity events. And those are the views of the CPAC members. Then it doesn't make sense. No, it's an endorsement of the report. You have to read that. Of course, this letter is issued with the ICAC letterhead, and no longer use CPAC members. No, we. Not, if you say it's not ICAC, no, we didn't say it's not ICAC, Kenneth. We're just seeking a simple clarification. We're talking about the same issue. From this letter, they jump from CPAC members to ICAC, so they have to explain why they do that. In the other report, it's only because Raymond Wong doesn't like this and then we don't talk about it. No, there can't be. On the director of orders explanation, I'm happy with it. Now, I'm not saying whether the explanation is right or wrong. We just asked for an explanation. What's the big deal here? Isn't the director of audit not supposed to give explanation? No, I'm not saying that. I think we could let the director of audit explain. I'm just saying that I'm happy with the explanation of the director of audit. Of course, you are entitled to your own different view. Have I said that I have a different view? No. Have I ever said that I have a different view, Kenneth Leung? No, I haven't said so, right? I'm just asking, and I'm just doing my duty. If you don't want to do your duty, it's fine for you. You can be like Raymond and say anything you like. Now, he's not here, fine. He's in and out, no problem. But here, for us, we have the duty as members of the PAC to find out why a term is used that way. Mr. Chairman, perhaps the members are all rather tired from filibustering. That's why there's quite a lot of sparks in many meetings. Now, not agitated or anything. But anyway, in the past half hour, you said we should wrap up this part. And for the past hour, we're talking about whether this suggestion is made by the ICAC or a committee of the ICAC. Actually, Mr. Alan Leung has already made a good suggestion. That is, we should ask for the letter between the Director of Audit and the ICAC Commissioner. With that letter, then we could discuss in more specifically the issue. No. Or maybe email. Or anyway, the correspondence. So I think with that in hand, it will be easier for us to conduct the discussion. I haven't spoken, Mr. Chairman. I've only spoken for 52 seconds. No, we are not questioning whether they accept it or not. They've explained it already. It's accepted because they've already explained it. But then members, what we're discussing here, should be when we draft a report, should be something when we draft a report, and it should be discussed in the closed meetings of the PAC. So, Mr. Chairman, therefore, we should wrap up discussion at this point and move on to the next part. I still have a lot of questions. Well, Mr. Chen, you could ask a lot of questions, but it's the duty of the chairman as to whether we wrap a discussion at this part. I don't think there's any difference at all. It's not even that we have different views, we just accept this recommendation, and I just want to ask a quick question. How come, Mr. Chairman, you know, as the chairman, I have to consider what to include in the report, you know. I just want to ask how come from a letter to the audit report is worded differently. It seems to be of a different level, you know, the organization being referred to. So I think mine is a fair question. It's not because the director of audit has written something in the report, then we don't question it. And no one's saying that it's wrong and the director of audit shouldn't have worded it that way. But we have the duty to ask about it. And even if we need another half an hour, if you're not happy, you could walk out. If you don't want to follow this discussion, and we can't say something in behind closed doors. We have to lay bare everything. No, please, no more arguments. I think we have spent quite a bit of time already. Not because we will have to write a report, so we have to be fair. But let's stop here. So we have to find out what it's all about. And as we want to find out what it's all about, we have to ask fair questions, okay? Paul, let's finish this. No, I'm not arguing. Now, we are taking evidence. I think at this point, we should refrain from giving our comments. And even if we are to give our comments, it's only to allow the witnesses an opportunity to respond. We shouldn't jump to conclusions so soon. But anyway, it was quite an unnecessary argument. It was just that we're talking cross purposes. Now, in the audit report, it refers to the ICAC, that's right. But then if you refer to Gen 14, it's true. At that time, the reference was to the CPAC. So there's a missing link here. That's the missing puzzle piece. That's how come it's become from a committee to the ICAC. I think if we have rational discussion, that's not a problem. Yes, that's why we have to find out about the facts first, because we are accountable to the witnesses as well. How we write the report, that's important. So it's not that because it's put this way in the audit report, we don't give them a chance to explain. No, it's not right. Mr. Wong, if I could just put on record, the letter we received as a member mentioned, the letter we received is the same wording as in Gen 14. It's not what's in paragraph 1.11 of the audit report. It's just for the record. Okay. Let's move on. Oh, let's take a break of 10 minutes. We'll come back. Do you need to serve herbal tea for all of us? Mr. Chairman, if I could just add, for paragraphs 1.10 and 1.11 of the audit report, as we drafted these paragraphs, we had regard to the assignment report of the ICAC's Corruption Prevention Department. And in this process, the message is, in this paragraph, the message we try to give out, and that's in the assignment report of the ICC, is that the ICC conducted such a study on the MEF, and that it, and then it published a report. And there's a recommendation given to the MEF in terms of its operation and continuation. So these are the two suggestions made. And when we drafted the report, we did not consider the fine details as covered today at the public hearing as to whether it is the recommendation of the ICC or the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee. And in drafting the report, when we considered the wordings, we thought that since the Corruption Prevention Department had this consideration, and so we thought we could represent the view as that of the ICC. So we made a decision in, as we drafted the report, that we would use the term ICC, and we considered it appropriate. The reason is that the Corruption Prevention Advisory Committee is a major part of the ICC, so that's why we chose to use this term ICC. Now, in the letter, CPAC members' views were cited, but as we drafted the audit report, we thought these views were part of the ICAC's views.
When we draft our report, we will criticize, we will, in 2012, 17th of April, Finance Committee, why they did not accept the CPAC suggestion. It's part of the ICAC. In our report, we need to state clearly. That's why I need to ask you and need you. I just want to follow up on the Secretary's comments. You cannot monopolize the proceedings. You were monopolizing the discussion. We need to draft a report. That's why we have to ask you these questions today. We need to understand why there was a discrepancy. We need to understand. Some members, some PAC members, feel it should not be asked, but they have the right. Okay, Wang Yongman. The MEF, they responded clearly that they only saw the Gen 14 letter and did not read paragraph 1.11. So in this report, they must have shown you this report. Did they show you this report? Chairman, the drafting is not this final version. That so your judgment was that, according to the contents of that letter, you made a judgment that the MEF should continue. Can I say that? It's not the letters or the content of the letter to decide whether the MEF can continue. Chairman, I just want to clarify. I respect members' decisions, but as a matter of fact, on this point, I just want to say our judgment at the time was based on the contents of the letter on November 15th, 2010. And this letter says CPAC members' opinion. So that's so I want to ask you, if you read, if you read 1.1, would that change your opinion? He already said that it was amended by ICAC. So I want to, I have a new question for him. Now you've read 1.11. You've read it just like I have. We don't agree with 1.11. That's it. Let's break for 10 minutes. We return at 12.